Fox 5 News Now, sponsored by SDCCU.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome into Fox 5 News Now, San Diego's only interactive digital newscast. My name is Matt Meyer here as your host, and we are brought to you, as always, by San Diego County Credit Union. Hey, take a look out our Westgate camera at beautiful downtown San Diego. You see the Coronado Bridge there in the background. It is set to be a beautiful Sunday here in San Diego, folks. And the good news is, too, warmer weather is coming. Well, good news probably for most of you. I'm sure that we're all up for a little bit of sunshine. I have your forecast coming up soon, including a pretty major warm-up. As we go today, please let me know what you're thinking about our different stories. You can drop me a comment on Facebook Live or on YouTube. You can also, if you're watching on our Fox 5 app, get in my Twitter mentions, at Matt Meyer News. I'll be checking those as we go. But again, happy to have you here on the show. Going to get to that forecast for you in a moment, but do want to start with the news that I kind of warned you about yesterday. If you were watching the show, we might be headed for this. Yes, sure enough, the Petco Park super vaccination site has been closed again. The closure was extended really through today, Sunday, and Monday. This, of course, due to the fact that San Diego still just doesn't have the vaccine supply that it needs. That, and we talked about this a great deal yesterday, as a result of the winter storm that has been kind of choking the infrastructure, the supply chain, in many parts of the country, especially the Moderna vaccine just has not gotten to San Diego at the rate that UC San Diego Health and the county need to be administering those shots at the Petco Park site. So just like I told you about the closure on Friday and Saturday, people who have appointments don't need to worry. They will be, I should say, rescheduled, but of course, some frustration there. The good news, just like yesterday, other vaccination sites around San Diego County are still open. So I know that the Grossmont Center Mall Superstation, which you're taking a look at here, also the Chula Vista Superstation, are still filling some appointments Sunday. There is a chance that people have had their vaccination appointments closed, or postponed. So I don't want to make any too sweeping statements. We have heard, we've gotten emails from some folks who have said that they have already had their appointments pushed at other sites around the county, not just Petco. But what I do know is that they are at least getting people through their second appointments for the vaccine. And primarily right now, what is available in the county is the Pfizer vaccine. So that is worth noting if you're someone who's looking for a second shot and you already got the Moderna shot, it is going to be in your best interest, of course, to wait to get that Pfizer shot so that, or the Moderna shots, that you keep aligned with what you got first. The good news is that the storm is starting to ease up around the country, and the federal government has said that they are expecting the vaccine rollout to get back on track soon. So of course we will be following that. But I wanted to take a look this morning at sort of the broader context that this is playing out in here in the state of California. Obviously, San Diego, one of the largest cities here in our state. And so we are often sort of at the whims or directly affected by things that are happening on that statewide level. We actually know that there is going to be a pretty big shift that has already started to happen in terms of the way the state is approaching the vaccine rollout. And that is in kind of enlisting the help of two private healthcare companies that are giants here in California. That's Blue Shield and Kaiser. You may have heard about this. Blue Shield is going to be helping the state and county governments as well with logistics for the rollout. So basically deciding where vaccine doses should be distributed. And then Kaiser is going to be running some mass vaccination sites. They're going to be vaccinating a larger number of their own members. So these two companies are stepping in and taking the reins from some of what the states and the counties were doing. There are proponents of this approach. There are people who are happy to hear this. And of course, there have been some people who have protested, who have said that they would prefer the counties to be in charge of this kind of rollout. But this all takes place, too, when Governor Gavin Newsom is facing political pressure on a bunch of different fronts regarding COVID-19, not just the vaccine rollout, but also school reopenings, business closures. And yes, there is actually a recall effort, not to mention the fact that he is running again for re-election in 2022, and he has a couple of challengers with San Diego ties, I'll add, who are ramping up their campaign. So lots to get to on that front. We have a show called Inside California Politics on Fox 5 San Diego. This interview just aired a couple of hours ago. I wanted to play it for you because it touches on a little bit of everything that we'll be going over today.
Sophia, I want to start with you because we've learned some more about this vaccination effort. We know that these two big healthcare giants are going to be heading this up. What do we know right now and what do we not know?
Yeah, so at this point, like you said, we know that two healthcare companies, Blue Shield of California and Kaiser Permanente, are going to be taking over some of the state's vaccination distribution work. We've seen the contract with Blue Shield, and essentially it's going to be developing algorithms that determine where vaccine doses go. And it's also going to be working with the state to improve data collection so that ostensibly we'll know more about where vaccines are going and how quickly they're getting out the door. The contract also sets some targets in terms of how many vaccines the state should be able to distribute or get into arms each week, depending on the supply that comes from the federal government.
John, there has been a lot of discussion about these two companies. Why were they chosen? Are they going to profit off of this? How important is it for the Newsom administration to be successful in this rollout?
I think it is incredibly important, Nikki. I mean, both from a policy perspective and a political perspective. Of course, what most people care about is the policy, right? That you get it right. You know, until Sophia's point, we know all these details of the contract tenant, but we still don't know exactly how Blue Shield will do all of this, what kind of time frame, and will that actually be a positive mode? You've got counties across California that have pushed back and said, we already have a plan in place and we're ramping up our efforts and we don't need another layer of bureaucracy. I think that's kind of their word, from the state or from any other entity. But politically, absolutely. I mean, the governor has, I think, been scrambling for weeks trying to explain why California's vaccination process seems so slow. It looks to have ramped up, though the data is still kind of hard to gather here. And this is a governor who is under fire on a lot of things that have happened under the COVID-19 pandemic and his administration of them. And vaccines, boy, right up there at the top.
And so you hear John referencing there, again, some of the political challenges that are facing Governor Gavin Newsom, not least of which are two different Republicans with San Diego ties. Here was Mayor Kevin Faulkner in San Francisco just a few days ago.
I'm running for governor for the great state of California because it's time for a California comeback.
And so you see him speaking there in front of a school bus. He was actually at a school in San Francisco as part of his push for the state to reopen schools more quickly. That is something that Governor Newsom has said he is trying to do. You are also seeing here Rancho Santa Fe businessman John Cox, another person who is mounting a potential challenge. So we have these two Republicans, again, former San Diego Mayor Kevin Faulkner, of course, who you all are familiar with, I'm sure, and then John Cox, who was actually Newsom's opponent back in 2018. They have both been ramping up, putting out ads, adding to their campaign war chests, so to speak, fundraising, and so those efforts are ramping up. In addition to that, there is, of course, an effort to recall Governor Gavin Newsom, which has reached over a million signatures. They will need 1.5 million verified by the state to get that on the ballot. Now, for his part, the governor has been touting his role as the leader of the state right now, saying that the state has now surpassed 7 million vaccines. He's been touring around to different sites, saying that we are making progress as the state. And he has sort of said that the recall effort is really political opportunism, that people like Cox, who you're seeing on your screen here, or Faulkner, see the recall effort as a way to ultimately weaken him for their eventual run for governor. So here in San Diego County, we are trying to get those vaccines to folks, and that is certainly something that is being seen across the state. Again, you're looking at that Grossmont Center vaccine site, one of the places that is still operating right now. And so as we continue to follow that, we'll be sure to update you. And of course, there's more to come on this. In the next week, we'll see if those vaccines start to get here. That might start to loosen the pressure, not just on county officials, but on Newsom himself. Of course, we'll be covering that in the weeks and months to come. In the meantime, want to say hi and thank you again for being here. If you're coming in a little bit late, this is an interactive news show, so please do let me know in the comments as we go today if you have questions or you just want to let me know where you're watching from. I'm happy to give you a shout out as well. And I'll say hi to a couple of you now. I see that Christina just chimed in the chat. She's saying that kids need to be in school. That is a major part of the equation. Governor Newsom has, in recent days, kind of stepped up his rhetoric around, yes, we can get kids back in schools. We can get them back safely with precautions, and the state will provide funding for that. Christina, in what you're referencing to, the key hangup has been debate about whether or not all teachers need to be vaccinated before they come back on campus. The CDC issued guidance, and I'm sure you've been following that, Christina, as someone who cares about that. But yes, a lot of folks right now pushing to get kids back in school. A lot of health concerns as well, not just for those teachers, but also for the kids. I want to say hi to a couple of others. I see that Yvonne is watching from Ontario, Canada. Thanks so much for being here. And then I saw Julie said, welcome to California. That's the San Diego spirit. I saw that Julie was saying that she misses Southern California in body surfing. Yeah, it's been too cool probably for many of you to have beach days, but we are going to get to that warm-up in your forecast in just a second. Maybe it would be a good opportunity to get out to the beach. Let's see. I see that Linda is here. Hi to her. Let's see. I see Rosalia saying that it's a very nice day here in San Diego. Yeah, we're looking at our Westgate camera here. Let's take a peek at Mount Soledad, too. I always like to pull that up. Let's take a look at our coastline. There we go. Yeah, nice pretty shot there down towards La Jolla. It should be a beautiful day wherever you are, Rosalia. I see that John is in the chat. Hello to him. Let's see, a couple of others. I see Aria is watching from Oceanside. So yeah, folks, thanks for being here. As we go today, do let me know questions, comments, or just let me know where you are watching from. But in the meantime, I want to get to that forecast that I've been teasing for you folks. It should be a beautiful day. It is going to be a little bit windy. But in the days to come, especially Monday, we are expecting some much warmer temperatures than we've had in recent weeks. Victoria Johnson has your forecast.
Happy Sunday. We are under a Santa Ana pattern with an offshore flow kicking up and high pressure building, bringing us warmer and windy days for the next couple of days, with these above average temperatures really peaking on Monday. Monday of this week is expected to be the warmest day, with well above average temperatures, by about 8 degrees warmer than average at the coast and 15 degrees above average inland. High rip current risk at the beaches today if you are planning on hitting the waves. Your surf report, 3 to 5 feet. And then late week, seeing a bit of a change, a little bit of a cool down, but still fair and dry weather coming up for the week ahead. Wind advisory continues for our valleys and our mountains until this afternoon, with some pretty strong winds still expected into our inland areas. Winds out of the northeast between 20 and 30 miles per hour for sustained winds, but we could see some stronger gusts well into the 40s and 50s for our inland valleys and also into our mountain locations. So we could see some blowing dust in the deserts. As we make our way through this evening, winds expected to not be as strong as early this morning and this afternoon. Today's highs, sunny skies, 70s across the board. 74 in Escondido, seeing 71 degrees in Ramona, cooler there in Julian, well into the upper 50s, but still temperatures about 90 degrees warmer today than what they were yesterday. If you are planning on heading to the beach, your water temperature hanging out in the upper 50s, your surf anywhere between 3 and 5 feet coming up for the next 7 days. Nice warm up as we make our way into Monday, then low 70s as we round out this week. A bit of a shift there from Monday into Tuesday as the Santa Ana pattern wraps up. We'll see onshore winds start to build as we make our way into the middle of the week, and then a nice temps there coming in for our inland areas. 77 today, 80 degrees on Monday and Thursday of this week, but sunny days and mostly clear skies coming up for the next week ahead.
Thanks to Victoria for that, showing you a little bit of video that we got of some of that wind around Southern California. So again, some gusty winds, some Santa Ana conditions in our forecast, but also those beautiful sunny days.
Fox 5 News Now, sponsored by SDCCU.
Thanks again for joining me on this Sunday morning on Fox 5 News Now, our interactive digital news show. It's brought to you by our friends at San Diego County Credit Union. And hey, I wanted to mention, you can watch our show on fox5sandiego.com. You can also watch it on social media, but really the best way to watch the show is on our Fox 5 app. You can download it with Android or iPhone. It's available on both kinds of devices, and you get an alert every time I go live. You also get breaking news alerts so that you're up to date on our top story. So did want to mention that the Fox 5 app is a great way to watch Fox 5 News now. And again, I am so grateful to those of you who are tuning in. Wanted to say hi to a couple more of you. I see that Tara is watching. I see Amer is watching. Also, Abraham, thank you for tuning in. I want to say hi to Meg, who is watching in Arroyo Grande, California. So not too far afield. And let's see, there was one other. Oh, there were a couple of messages that I wanted to read. So I saw that Denise was saying, so she's expressing maybe a little bit of frustration or at least a desire to get vaccinated. She's saying that right now, because they're only doing 65 and over, that's for the most part. There are, of course, health workers who are also getting vaccinated, and there have been some limited exceptions. But you're right, Denise, that the vast majority of people getting vaccinated right now are 65 and up. Denise is saying she's 52, so nowhere near that 65, in that she works for the school district. So she's certainly hoping to get vaccinated before going back to school in person. Saw a couple of other people talking about, talking about going back to school, people saying that that online school isn't cutting it for them, in that they're really hoping to get kids back in the classroom. And that's certainly something that we've heard from other folks as well. So everybody trying to do their best to figure out the school situation in terms of getting kids finally back in the classroom. Other states have been. California has not been for the most part. It's worth noting that when we talk about this, there are some schools in San Diego that are back in some form of hybrid learning. So certain schools around the county are actually doing that. I'll show this video here. This is Vista Grande. This is an elementary school in El Cajon where they do actually have some of their students back in the classroom. You can see the precautions that they have in place. The teacher there wearing a mask, and of course the students wearing a mask. They also are tested regularly before their classes. So there are sort of some local examples of our schools here in San Diego County that are actually having at least some kids back on campus. And that kind of gives us a glimpse at the future. But certainly I know for a lot of you folks, that is just not happening in your community. And I feel you there. I'll say hi to Carlos, who is watching from his house in Imperial Beach. Nice little wave emoji. Hey, Carlos, probably a beautiful day to get out to the beach. You're pretty close there. So I hope you enjoy it. Anyway, folks, wanted to get you to some new images that we got overnight. Well, because it happened late overnight. This happened in Australia. Number one ranked Novak Djokovic won at the Australian Open. Again, we just got these images in this morning because the match happened while most of us were asleep down in Australia. That is his ninth win at the Australian Open, and that makes it 18 Grand Slam victories for him overall. That is just two shy of the record at 20. And if you missed it on Saturday for the women's final at the Australian Open, Naomi Osaka, sort of the ascendant young women's tennis star, someone that a lot of people who are fans of the sport really just enjoy watching play the game. She won the women's final. She took her fourth Grand Slam trophy by defeating American Jennifer Brady. She has won her last 21 matches dating back to last season.
Fox 5 News Now, sponsored by SDCCU.
Wanted to give you an update on a story that broke yesterday after I got off with you folks, but it is still a top story on Fox5SanDiego.com, and it is not hard to understand why. Did you see this video? This is video of a catastrophic engine failure on a United flight that took off from Denver en route for Honolulu, Hawaii. You can see the state that the engine was in. The pilots immediately realized what was going on. This was shortly after takeoff, and they started to circle back to make an emergency landing back there in Denver. As they circled back, the plane did rain some debris down onto the suburbs of Denver surrounding the airport there. But the great news is, and this is remarkable, no one on the plane was hurt. That, of course, a credit to the pilots in large part. Also, no one on the ground was hurt as this debris was falling from this plane. Again, this was in the Denver area. So obviously, shook up the neighborhood, regardless of no one being hurt. Because no one was hurt, it sort of took on this interesting spectacle there on the ground where all the neighbors were walking around kind of like, what exactly just happened? We got a chance to catch up with a couple of them. Wanted to play that for you because, again, this remains a top story on our website right now.
My first thought was that the whole plane was coming down.
That was the reaction from Kirby Clements when he looked out his window Saturday afternoon.
We heard this big bang.
And saw this.
Well, I didn't know how bad the wind was blowing, so I thought it had picked maybe my neighbor's trampoline up and blew it in there. But as soon as I stood up and looked and saw the whole piece, that I knew right away that it was the front end of an engine.
The massive piece of metal clipped the front of his garage and smashed into his truck before resting on the ground.
It missed being directly above us by less than 10 feet. So yeah, it would have been, that big a piece would have gone through our roof.
That seemed to be the biggest piece of debris to fall from the sky in their neighborhood, but it wasn't the only one. Other smaller parts were scattered throughout their block.
Just another casual Saturday.
Dozens of others came out trying to get a look at the piece that nearly caused serious damage. Video shows investigators picking up the pieces, then United Airlines trucks driving away with them.
Pretty amazing that nobody got hurt.
A narrow miss, turning a near tragic story into the talk of the neighborhood.
I don't think most people have seen anything like this before. And it's kind of an unusual thing to have happen to your neighborhood.
I like the guy who said just another average Saturday. I'll get that graphic out of the way so that you can see one more kind of zoomed in look at that engine. Obviously scary moments for the people who were on that flight, but again, a credit to the pilots that they got it safely back on the ground. We talked to some aviation experts after this, like we always do when we see things like this. They told us that an engine failure of that kind is extremely rare, but that pilots are trained. They do practice with how to deal with an engine failure like that. Again, nobody was hurt. Federal transportation authorities now investigating what exactly went wrong there, how that engine ended up failing as we get that information. Again, another example of a story that I might send a push alert to you for on our Fox 5 app so that you can stay updated on that story. Want to say hi to a couple more of you who just hopped in the chat here. I see that Charmaine is saying, thank God no one got hurt. Yeah, pretty remarkable. I liked the guy with the sort of wry smile who just kind of said, yeah, just another Saturday. Not exactly. I see that Lindsay also saying that it was a miracle that no one got hurt. So yeah, I mean, a pretty remarkable story there. Again, this video is just, I mean, you don't see things like this every day. So that story did come out yesterday, but if you folks missed it, I wanted to make sure you saw it again. Hey, want to get you to a couple more stories that I'll be following for you in not just today, but in the days to come. And then I'll get you out of here on your Sunday. But I do want to start with the search continuing for a missing South Bay mother. This is Maya Millette. We have talked about her on the show several times. She's been missing for over a month and a half now. She's a mother of three from Chula Vista. You're seeing photos of her there. I wanted to let you know I got you to this map here because the family is organized, or at least people, it's not a police effort. This is a private effort by family and friends who have organized a search party. This is sort of in the Bonita area. You see the freeways coming together there so that you can get a good idea of where exactly we're talking about, but near the intersection of Quarry Road and Sweetwater Road, again, in sort of the Bonita area. So in the South Bay there, the family is going to be searching the brush over that way. The last update that I brought you on the show on Millette's story was actually that the family had headed out to the Glamis Sand Dunes in hopes that they might find her out there. The family had camped there frequently, so there was some family connection there, and they had a feeling that she may be out in that direction. Unfortunately, that was not the case, so now they are, again, organizing this local search today. That one is going to start at 1 p.m. We do have more information about that search on our Scene On tab if you're interested in learning about that. Also happening today, San Diego's first in-person music festival since the start of the pandemic is wrapping up. You're seeing video here from Switchfest on Friday night. This is in Oceanside, but it ran Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. You can see they essentially set things up with the same precautions that allow restaurants to be operating outdoors right now. So tables spaced out and people sitting only with their party who they arrived with, masks on in the common areas, like you're seeing folks standing back by the bathroom, maybe they're wearing their masks. People at the table enjoying their food and drinks. But yeah, an in-person music festival for the first time, again, in San Diego since the pandemic. This was at the Switchboard Restaurant and Finn Hotel in Oceanside, if you're familiar with that area. And it's a showcase for local musicians. So the folks that you're seeing perform here are some of our struggling local artists who have not been able to do live gigs. They got a chance to get out and do that. And I wanted to play for you. We got to talk to one of the organizers and also one of the artists. They were just glowing after getting to play this show. Obviously something that they've had to wait quite a while to do again.
We're used to being in our living rooms or trying to stream shows and looking at my phone all the time. So it's like, oh man, there's people and what are they gonna think?
Everyone's being so respectful tonight. No one's speaking over each other. No one's getting in each other's faces because they're too excited. Everyone understands the reality of it.
Just got you to some of the sights and sounds there. I thought that that was pretty cool. Hey, looking one more time at downtown San Diego. It's a beautiful day and I want to send you out on it. I'm going to say hi to my last person here, give my last shout out. I see that Debbie, Debbie Meyer. Hey, we share a last name. Debbie is tuning in. She says, hi, Matt Meyer. Maybe there's some distant familial connection there, Debbie. But hey, good to see you. I also see that Lisa is watching and Eddie are watching. They just snuck in under the wire. Hi guys, thanks for tuning in. If you missed the beginning of the show, once this is over, the show is still available to watch back on our Fox 5 app. Again, you can download that Android and iPhone. Folks, I always promise to leave you with something to smile about. Today we are going to marvel at nature, which always seems to do surprising and incredible things. This is the firefall at Yosemite, and this is an annual thing, so you may have seen these incredible photos before. I'll get that graphic out of the way for you so that you can see it even better there. So this is an optical illusion, essentially, that occurs just in sort of a narrow window every February, from like February 12th to February 24th this year is when they're thinking this is going to last. What you were looking at there, that's Horsetail Falls. You see the people set up to look at it. This is Horsetail Falls. It plunges about 1,500 feet, and when the sun is setting, it hits the light, I should say, hits the water just right to get that incredible sort of lava pouring look. I think that is fantastic. And hey, if the great outdoors isn't something to smile about, I don't know what is. And with that, go enjoy it. Have a great Sunday. As Brad Wills likes to say, make it the best weekend ever. I hope that you do. I want to say thank you again to you folks for tuning in and letting me know what you think about our stories as I went today. I'll be back Saturday and Sunday next week at 10 a.m. Until then, thanks again for watching, and a big thanks to San Diego County Credit Union for sponsoring the show. See you folks next week.
Fox 5 News Now, sponsored by SDCCU.